I think we have Chief Larkin and Chief Deputy Clark here, so we're gonna go ahead and get started. Thanks for joining us, everyone. I think, as many of you know, the weather was not as bad last night as it could have been, but that does not mean we're out of the woods yet. So I actually want to lead off a little bit with the National Weather Service to give us a brief update on what we're looking at tonight and going forward. Brian, go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. Brian Garcia, National Weather Service meteorologist down here. I'm going to go ahead and share. Oh, I cannot share my screen. So what we're looking at in terms of weather going forward through the night is we actually have an area of low pressure up off the Pacific Northwest that's going to dive south towards us. As it does that, it's actually going to wrap that frontal boundary that came through last night back up a little bit. And so not only do we have that, but we also have what we call convective showers coming in with this low as it drops in. So what do I mean by convective showers? That means essentially like thunderstorm looking type things. So very tall towering cumulus clouds that'll stream into Santa Cruz County from the southwest. As such, we can expect some pretty robust showers moving through the county tonight that could lay down rain rates that could meet our thresholds for flash flood warnings for the post-wildfire debris flows. Having all that in mind, we continue to have the flash flood watch in place, and we will have that in place into Thursday morning so that we can catch any of those showers by that. So as we see showers roll in that meet threshold and meet criteria, we'll go ahead and issue a flash flood warning for that. So it's really important for people to realize that despite today being relatively dry when you woke up, not much rain going around, just a few showers passing, that things aren't necessarily better right now. It just means we're in a break. So we knew this was coming, that we'd get the system through last night, that we'd get the wind with it, and that we'd have a break today, and we'll get the second punch, essentially like the sucker punch, coming through tonight with showers. The winds will also come up a little bit. It'll get a little breezy, but nowhere near what we saw last night. And then it will all kick through by the time we get into Thursday afternoon, and especially Friday morning, all of those showers will move off to the east. So in short, flash flood watch remains in place. We expect the possibility of some flash flood warnings overnight along at the CZU. So make sure that you be safe and be careful out there.
Great. Thank you, Brian. Chief Clark, if you're on the line and you can talk a little bit about our continued response to this event, please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks, Jason. Hello, everybody. So, you know, we were hoping for better weather. And we mentioned this yesterday that, you know, we were really taking this kind of hour by hour. And that's exactly what happened throughout the night. Last night, we did see threshold level rain in and around Boulder Creek in the North Coast. And luckily, and I'll have Chief Larkin talk about some infield inspections that are occurring as we speak. We were hoping for better, and we absolutely empathize that for those that are displaced from their homes, that you want to get back home. And so, you know, we want that to happen as well. We just want to make sure that, you know, we're protecting everybody that lives in those areas where a debris flow could, you know, endanger you and your family. So that, and we're continuing, you know, we lean heavy on the National Weather Service. You just heard Brian Garcia speak about the weather that's coming. And we rely heavily on our partners with our geology partners with regards to how that weather interacts with the burn scar. And so, again, we take this extremely seriously. We take your safety extremely seriously. And so we're going to continue to monitor that as we go along, and we'll absolutely get you back home as quick as we can. And so I just wanted you to know that. And then with regards to kind of just some things last night, you know, we had deputies working, as I mentioned. We had, in terms of calls for service, we didn't have any welfare checks. We didn't see any suspicious person or activity type calls, which was good. And we didn't have any reports of burglaries. And so I believe that to be a positive thing. And so today we'll have 14 deputies working the area up in the San Lorenzo Valley looking for people that hopefully aren't out there looking to victimize people. But nonetheless, we'll be doing looter suppression type security patrols in and around the San Lorenzo Valley today. And we'll continue that tonight with an additional 10 deputies working tonight, starting at 7 p.m. and then rolling into Thursday morning. And so before I turn it over to Chief Larkin, just again, I can't stress to reiterate, you know, paying attention to the National Weather Service and paying attention to social media with regards to the changing nature of this weather. If you haven't already, register for Code Red. We've said this a number of times. You get a lot of information if and when things happen through Code Red. And then again, know your zone. And so if you're not familiar, hopefully you are, but that community.zonehaven.com website with regards to knowing where you are and what area you're in when it comes to an evacuation order or warning. And so I'll turn it over to Chief Larkin. He's got some information with regards to what our geology partners are doing and our fire personnel out in the field. So with that, I'll turn it over to Chief Larkin.
Thanks, Chief Deputy Clark. Yeah, I just want to reiterate, the storm did meet a lot of thresholds in some of the areas that are of concern to us that could create debris flows. So we are actively out. The Van Lomond, Boulder Creek, and Felton Fire Departments are out actively looking at their areas of concern. And there has been some reports that came back just on some windshield surveys that they're doing out there where there's some indications of where there may be some movement of some land. So our county geologist, as well as I believe there's some state geologists that are headed our way to go and survey those areas and kind of give us a better idea of what is occurring out there in those areas where the debris flows have been identified as having potential. So that's an ongoing process. We'll continue to evaluate that. As far as the fire departments are concerned, we've take preemptive actions to pre-position a special rescue task force in the event that we do have a debris flow. Those folks are available to us immediately to get them in when it's safe to do so to start surveying the debris flow and potentially affecting rescues if need be, recoveries in the event of a debris flow. We did get a lot of rain last night. Though it may have not meant the potentials that were predicted, it did provide us our first real significant wetting rain here over the burn scar and in the county. So that's something to be cautious about. And we're taking those preemptive measures in that consideration with this incoming storms to make sure that we're providing for the public safety. That's all I have.
Great. Thank you, Chief Larkin. So we're going to go to questions. If you have a question, raise your hand in the participant window. Before we do that, I have a couple of notes just on the storm response. We do have some road impacts. You can find those at sccroadclosure.org. Smith Grade is closed down near Back Ranch. We're checking out some scattered reports of rock falls and things like that. East Cliff at Corcoran Lagoon is closed due to flooding. That's a frequent occurrence if you live in Santa Cruz County. Our call center will stay open. If you need anything, call 831-454-2181. If you want to check on state highways like Highway 9, just go to roads.dot.ca.gov. We will be closing two of the temporary evacuation points at 1 o'clock today. Those are the Davenport and the Scotts Valley TEPs. The SLV center will stay open. That was by far our most heavily used site. And with that, let's go to the top here and take a question from Nikki Barr at the local.
Thanks, Jason. I think this question is for Chief Deputy Clark. I'm wondering how you think about evacuations tonight. We already saw at least a few hundred people resistant to leaving their homes last night. The worst case scenarios thankfully didn't manifest, but are you concerned about people not taking the ongoing evacuations as seriously tonight and possibly returning home? And then second part, could we see any changes in warnings and evacuation orders for any zones across the county? Thanks.
Yeah, hi Nick. So no, I don't anticipate any further evacuation warning or order areas, but obviously it's something to pay attention to. And again, paying attention to community.zonehaven.com for that info. So I don't see anything necessarily changing, but you never know what could happen. But with regards to people that chose to remain, it's an ongoing concern. I mean, that's why we did all the messaging that we did, and that's why honestly we're continuing with the evacuation order now. If we, we want people to go home, but we want to keep people safe. And so this weather as it comes in is a concern, which is obviously why that order is staying in place. So for the people that are remaining, and that are choosing to make that, decision to stay, I can't stress more that you just need to be absolutely as aware that to the weather situation and know your options, know how to get out, but again, things can change there. I mean, a tree could fall over a road, you could get trapped. So, we're hoping for better weather tomorrow, but again, we're continuing to monitor it. I'd encourage you to continue to seek shelter elsewhere if you've chose to stay, just because it's just an extra layer of protection for you and your family, and you wouldn't want anything to happen. So, obviously the order's in place to protect people. We'd encourage people if they thought about staying to seek shelter elsewhere and continue to do that until this team and the National Weather Service and our geology partners advise that it's safe for you to go home.
Great, thank you. Why don't we go to Paul Rogers? Paul, go ahead and unmute yourself and ask your question.
This one is one for Chief Clark and one for Chief Larkin. Chief Clark, what would you say is your goal for lifting the evacuation order? Obviously, it's going to be raining later today and tonight. Are you hopeful that it's going to be lifted tomorrow, or could it go into the weekend? And then for Chief Larkin, you mentioned some areas of geologic concern. Could you talk a little bit more about that, sort of generally where those are and what people are seeing? I mean, are they seeing slides happening, or what are they seeing? And finally, for Chief Larkin, do you have any idea how many responses you guys had to down trees up in the mountains and whether any of them hit houses? Thanks.
Yeah, hi, Paul. So to speak to the question with regards to how these decisions are made, maybe I can explain it. Within our Emergency Operations Center, within our Unified Command Team, we have our experts, and those experts being the National Weather Service, Brian Garcia, Dr. Mark Stredley with the county, he's a county hydrologist, Jeff Nolan, who's a county geologist. These are our experts that we take very seriously. We listen to them. And so in these situations where they see weather that's concerning, that potentially meet, that threshold level and in an area where they believe that a debris flow could happen, we take, we act on that information, and that's what creates those evacuation orders and those evacuation warnings. But, we're in contact throughout the day. We're watching this. I mean, this is our number one priority. There's not much else we're doing other than wanting to maintain public safety and keeping an eye on the weather and keeping people safe that are up there. Hopefully that answers your question, Paul.
Well, I mean, what are they telling you about when they hope to be able to lift those? Because people want to know, when can I go home, right? So we got to give them some general context. Is tomorrow likely? Is that what you're hoping for? I mean, give folks a little bit more context if you could, please.
Yeah. We were hoping, frankly, we were hoping for today. But it wasn't until that weather, those storms, as Brian mentioned, those thunderstorms, it looks like they're going to move into our area later this afternoon and tonight. We were hoping for better weather today to where we wouldn't see rain that would meet that threshold. That's what we were hoping for. And that didn't happen. So I think, and Brian maybe can explain a little bit about what maybe the predicted weather looks like, because that's what the conversation looks like. It's kind of like, hey, Brian, as we have these meetings, tell us more about the weather. And so I don't know, Brian, if you want to expand on that with regards to any extended prediction going into tomorrow.
Yeah, Paul, just to put it short and sweet, yes, we expect the weather to begin to ease after tonight, and we should see those showers really start to taper in strength and intensity. So at that point, we don't expect any further threats to meet thresholds for post-wildfire debris flows.
Thanks. And I think, Paul, you also had a question for Chief Larkin about whether there were reports of property damage or injuries with you or any of the other fire agencies.
Yeah, and where those slides that he mentioned were, the areas of concern specifically.
Yeah, Paul. So there's a couple different areas that we've gotten reports back where there's been indications of some indicators of some potential land movement. And some of that is on Jameson Creek Road up in Boulder Creek. As well as we had some reports of remnants of what appeared to be mud or debris that had come across the roadway on Alba Road. So There's definitely indicators that, you know, the soils are becoming, starting to absorb that moisture and becoming, having that potential to start to move. So the geologists are out there doing that survey to confirm those initial windshield surveys. So we hope to have more information later this afternoon when those folks get back in and be able to report back to us what they're seeing out in the field. And the second part of your question, we did have, it was relatively a quiet night last night as far as calls for service. We did have a few trees come down throughout the county that took a, I think there was one or two that may have struck a couple structures, and the others caused road closures. So it was relatively, other than that, it was very, very calm night.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hannah Hageman, you're next.
Hi, this is Hannah with the Sentinel. This question is in part for Brian Garcia with National Weather Service. Brian, that part of the storm system you're discussing, the frontal boundary that's expected to come back up, was that a recent development, and is it a part of the storm we saw last night? Is the first part of the question. The second part of the question is, are there characteristics of this boundary you're discussing that are concerning in terms of evacuation orders? I know there's been discussion about tailoring evacuation orders to the weather pattern. So that is the second part of the question.
Yeah, great questions, Hannah. Thanks for those. So the in terms of the boundary that has slipped south overnight last night, and it stalled out. So kind of as this whole system from just off the Pacific Northwest starts to slide down towards us, it's going to try to suck that back up into itself. And as it does that, we're going to see that boundary start to lift through Monterey County and curl up through San Benito, potentially get in into Santa Clara County. And so we always have to watch that. Whenever we start getting in that realm, right now, none of our numerical models are showing that that boundary that we saw last night slipping back into Santa Cruz County over the CZU. But we always have to watch that because there's always air in these models as well. But what we're really watching is all of those showers that are wrapping around from the north, and they're wrapping around the underside of that area of low pressure. And those showers could intensify. We're already seeing showers up across Sonoma County that are producing hail. And if we're seeing those right now, today, we didn't expect to see hail this early. We're expecting to see it later in the afternoon. So these showers are actually showing a bit more oomph and strength than what was initially expected. So as those wrap around tonight, we really got to pay attention to those and pay close attention to the intensity of rain rates that could potentially come down out of those. So in terms of your other question, if I heard it right, it has to do with kind of the blend between weather and evacuations. And maybe Chief Clark can help me out with this one, but we definitely are in close partnership and close communication with the County of Santa Cruz. We had somebody in the incident command post last night providing direct on-site weather support for the team there. And we do that from the office here when we're not in person. So we're giving the best information that we can. I'm sure you can probably see over my shoulder all the computers sitting behind me. We're constantly looking at this stuff, trying to assess when the worst of it is going to be over. So as soon as that point hits, we're trying to give that information to the decision makers in the county so that they can make the decisions ultimately as to when to repopulate these areas. So at that point, it's in the county's hands, it's in CAL FIRE's hands, and I'm gonna let Chief Clark talk on that one.
No, Brian, you pretty much summed it up. That's basically, I mean, that's the partnership that we have with the experts in these fields. And so, we're locked at the hip as we go through this and we'll provide you absolutely as much information as possible when we get it, as soon as we get it.
Great, thank you. Let's go to Kara Guzman.
Just to clarify. Okay.
Sorry, we're gonna move on. We gotta go to Kara real quick.
Thank you. Quick question on the road closures you mentioned. Do you have a timeline for reopening?
So Kara, we don't have DPW on the line, but in general, I know that the Smith grade closure has to do with trees and wires down. So we need to get PG&A out there. I'm sure they're there on site right now before we can get the tree out of there. And our crews are heading up right now to some of those scattered reports that Chief Larkin mentioned about rock falls and boulders and things like that. So they're going to work on an ASAP. Does that help?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, we got a lot of questions on road stuff. That helps. Thanks.
Sure. Adriana Frederick, go ahead.
Yes, good morning. My question is if you guys know how many residents are without electricity right now.
Let me take a crack at that. Adriana, that's a PG&E question. People can go to pg&e.com/outages. I went there this morning. It's surprisingly low. It appeared to be about 500 in the county, but you can check it out there and they'll give you an estimate on the number of people without outages, without power. If that
okay,
helps.
Thank you. Right. Thank you, yes.
Michelle Loxton, go ahead.
Michelle Loxton, KEZU. Jason, just to ask, will you be sending us the file again, once again at the end of this Zoom call to the email list?
Absolutely. Yep.
Great, thank you. And just to confirm with the temporary evacuation points, the only one staying open is the San Lorenzo Valley High School in Felton. And is that gonna be throughout the night tonight?
That is correct, yes.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Nick, you have another question?
Yeah, this one's for Brian Garcia. Thanks, Jason. Brian, I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit more comparing the forecast for tonight with what residents around the CZU Burnscar experienced last night in terms of the intensities of rains they should expect. Are they similar, less, more? Can you just a little comparing and tell us what might be the same or different? And the second question, is there any reason to worry about a cumulative impact for soil moisture around, you know, slides? Is that something we've had one night of rain, another night of rain? Is a cumulative moisture in the soil a concern? Thanks.
Yeah, great question, Nick. Thanks for those. So in terms of the comparison between last night and tonight, last night was a band of showers that was shifting from north to south across us. Or it's a line of rain that shifted from north to south across us. Tonight will actually be showers that are cutting in from the southwest up into the county. So instead of that band, that line that was sliding across, it's gonna be much more cellular in nature. So you'll literally see spots of showers. So you might be under a shower for just a couple minutes. That is a heavy, intense downpour. And then that passes and there will be no rain on you at that point. So it's gonna be much more of that type of feature. In terms of the intensity between last night and tonight, take last night's intensity as like the peak we could see tonight and a little bit less. So it's a little bit weaker, but even with a little bit weaker, we can still eclipse those thresholds for the potentiality of post-wildfire debris flows. So we've really gotta be careful with that. And now I completely forgot your second question, Nick. Can you say that again?
Yeah, is there any reason that you're concerned about having back-to-back rainfall in these areas and some kind of accumulation?
Right. Yeah, so in terms of soil saturation, I'm not a geomorphologist or a geologist, but the grounds have been so dry this winter. Going into the system, we were only about 30, maybe 40% of the average annual precipitation to this point. So with the ground so dry, they're able to absorb a lot of that water. So in terms of the soil saturation, we don't have a large concern, but that's actually something that's probably best to follow up on with the USGS. And those are our partners that we use to determine the soil saturation across the Bay Area in these types of events.